This video is about how to paint realistic fur in watercolour. I've got 10 quick tips for you, which I've recorded whilst working on painting a red panda. I hope they will help when you are painting furry animals in the future. Let's get on with our first tip, which, as you can see, is before I even start to work on the animal. Okay, I'm just applying some masking fluid to the outline of this red panda. I'm using an old size 00 brush here and a cocktail stick, and I can flick out, whilst it's wet, some fine lines from the masking fluid. Now what that will give you is some very fine lines for when we add the background on. So when the background's all dry, add it all the way around the edge here, I can peel all this off, and we'll have all these little fine lines, all these fine white marks where the edge of the fur goes for this lovely red panda. Now, as you can see, the background's nice and dry, and I've just started taking off this masking fluid. And what I'm doing, I'm rolling from the outside in, because I don't want to, you know, cause any tears, because sometimes, as we know, masking fluid can tear the paper. And when it does that, it's a bit of a pain. So it's going to tear, let it tear inside towards the subject, because at least that way around, you can then cover that up with any detail work, rather than trying to repair something in the background, which can be a bit tricky. Okay, so that's it. So you can see the idea of the cocktail stick and how that's worked. Get rid of that. And all the little spikes we've got from that. Now, when I'm working on a drawing, ready for painting, I know that as soon as I apply some wetting wet washes over this red panda, these pencil marks just disappear on me. So what I tend to do is go over the pencil marks with a little bit of watery paint. Now, the colour depends on the subject, obviously. In this case, because it's a red panda, it's more of a browny, kind of burnt sienna-y colour. So this colour will be fine. And this will help preserve those pencil marks. Not completely, sometimes they still wash away. But at least that way around, you won't have to redraw that image over the top, or less chance of doing so. Now while I'm working on this, you can see again, I'm just leaving that wet edge there. There's a roll of water. Run of water, just there, look. And the water will only go where the paper's wet. And the paint will only go where the paper's wet as well. So it shouldn't run down the paper unless you've got your kind of pad at one heck of an angle. So don't have your pad too angled, and that should stay put. So I'm trying to maintain those little rolls, those little runs of water, just like along here and there, a little bit here as well. Just maintain those wet areas. By the time we get down there, it should still be wet. But just keep an eye on it as well. So when you're working on something like the ear, there's one up here, okay? And you're dropping those colours in. But I'm constantly keeping an eye on these runs of water to make sure they're not starting to dry up on me. I just want to be able to keep bringing it down and down and down until I've got the entire head and body covered. So I need that first layer of detail. Now, as I did say earlier on, you can add as many layers as you want to add. Entirely your choice. I like to add probably sometimes 3 or 4. Depends really on the subject, really, to be honest with you. But if you think that, you know, after 3 layers, you think, okay, I'm happy with that now, that will do. Leave it at that. It's not a problem at all. Really isn't. Must have seen this before. Is my little replicator brush. Homemade, I call it the replicator brush. And even the handle's all broken there, look. You know, it doesn't matter. It's an old throwaway binnable brush. And I've got a little video on how to make these as well. I'll pop a link to the top right. And all it simply is, I use it like a comb brush, like a rake brush. There's a different ones on the market, as you know. So if I get some scrap watercolour paper again, look, and you can use this to create, get some more paint on it first of all. You can use this to create little lines like so, to create lots and lots of fur lines for that first layer. Got the idea? Look how quick that's done that, look. I know. And that's what I would recommend, to kind of cover a large area a little bit quicker without rushing. Remember, you don't rush your painting, okay? So I'm going to carry on with this again, working from that central line on the forehead here, right down the middle, and gradually branching that away. Now, we know this area is really, really dark on the reference photograph, don't we? But we still need to think about the lines that's in there. So still add those lines in. Okay, still paint them in as I'm doing now. And even though, as I said, we'll be sinking a lot of this detail back when we add the top layer of detail on there, then, you know, we still want some of it to show through. So look at the brush direction, from what you can see anyway, and sort of think about, well, which way would the fur go? So you can see it's going that way, because you just make out the side ones of these, can't you? So you want to put those in that way. So that means it's going to continue up like that, isn't it? In that sort of direction. And the same down here, look. So that sort of goes in that direction down there, very similar direction. And so that means around there will be very similar as well. However, when you get to this area, when you get round there, then you tend to find it sort of goes that way, over the top of that orange hint that's in there. Which goes around there, sort of curls around where the paw is. And you've got one here which goes over the top of the paw. So again, look at the direction. Think about the sweeping motion when you're adding this on. Now the paw itself, what I suggest you do, because there's quite a lot of different angles there, isn't there? Put a few little reference marks in places. So around here, for this toe, it goes around that direction, sort of curls towards, probably towards about 7 o'clock. Okay, so these lines go in that general direction around there. I can see a hint more red in there as well, actually. So what I might do, just grab a small amount of alizarin crimson and pop that in there. Just grab some of that, okay, on the tip of my brush. And we can add some of that slight change of colour in there as well. And it can keep switching your colours back and forward, you know. So if you think you need a bit more blue in there, add a bit more blue, a bit more red, add a bit more red, and so on. You're in charge of your painting, remember. Now when I'm working on details, especially fur like this, I like to work in different layers, okay? So probably 4, maybe 5 layers on average, something like that. And every layer will get darker and darker and deeper in tone. And every layer, by the way, there'll be fewer details. So I want all the other details underneath to still show through. So when we get to the darkest layer, then I'll just reduce the amount of lines that I use. So on this red panda, as you can see I'm working on, the layers are all done bit by bit, very carefully with my size 00 brush. And when I'm adding the colours in, let's go for this really bright colour. I'm thinking about the direction of the fur, of course, all the layering work can do here, so lots and lots of layers. But I'm also looking at the direction it goes. Have you noticed when you look at most animals, in fact, probably everyone I've seen so far, I've been doing this a few years doing this, that when you look down the centre of the head, through the middle of the nose, between the middle of the eyes, that the hairs tend to fan out like that. Okay? So imagine a line going down all the way through and they fan away like so. Not like a pair of curtains, but sort of, but kind of overlapping as well in places. So imagine that when you're working on a pet portrait. So that way you can look at getting those brush strokes and the direction of those hairs just right. Normally when I load a brush, I'll load it, I'll roll it, okay, like so. And then what I'll do, I'll tap it on some kitchen roll. But what I'm going to do now, I'm actually going to load it, and I'm going to tap it and flatten it against the side of the mixing bowl like that. Because that will then give me, make sure it's nice and creamy, give me a nice, flat, chiseled edge, okay? So it's nice and flat. You can just about see there, look. And when I work with a flat, chiseled edge, I can use that long, thin chisel to add the finest, the very finest of marks within this little red panda painting of mine. These very tiny marks of white hairs. And that's how I'd normally use watercolour white, especially when your brush is getting a little bit old and worn. It's a good way of doing it. Now when I'm working on whiskers, what I like to do is practice it first of all. So I load the brush up, my size 00, load it, roll it as you pull away, give it a tap on some kitchen roll. But when you apply it to the paper, what you want to do, use a very light hand. Think about the natural arc on your hand as you do this. So you may have to turn your paper around to get the right angles. And all I'm doing is barely touching. I'm going to ghost first of all, okay? That's what I call it, ghost in the area. Then barely touching the watercolour surface and then take that little angle all the way down using the arc of your hand, that natural curve, okay? And this is how I would work with painting whiskers. Just remember not to overload that brush because that's so, so important. I hope these tips have helped you. If you'd like to see more tips on painting fur, head to the video to the top right. I'll see you there.